भगवत गीता, सो वी आर डिस्कसिंग भगवत गीता एज इट इज. हाउ मेनी चैप्टर्स भगवत गीता हैज? 18 चैप्टर्स. एंड हाउ मेनी वर्सेस? 700 वर्सेस. यू माइट से व्हाट्स सो बिग थिंग इन दिस 18 चैप्टर 700 वर्सेस. एवरी बुक हैज सम चैप्टर्स एंड सम वर्सेस, बट द पॉइंट इज इफ यू नो अबाउट वेदास, आवर बुक्स ऑफ सनातन धर्म, Vedas are very big. There's Rig Ved, Yajur Ved, Sam Ved, Athar Ved, Upanishads are there. And then you have Puranas, Itihas, Panchratra, Ramayana, Mahabharata. If you take all of those, there are crores and crores of verses. For example, Rig Ved has 1 crore verse. What Rig Ved we have now? Much of the Rig Ved is lost. So 1 crore verses of Vedas. Mahabharata has some, I think, how many verses? 1 lakh verses. And Bhagavatam has 18,000 verses. Padma Purana has 25,000 verses. If you combine everything, his life is short to read all this knowledge. And after reading all that knowledge, then you will come to some conclusion. That is why Krishna came 5,000 years ago. And he summarized all that knowledge in 18 chapters and 700 verses. And that is why this book is special. And it is said that Sarva Upanishad Gavo Dogda Gopala Nandana. If you put all Vedas, all Upanishads together, and if you take out the essence of that, that is this book. So one option is you can read all Vedas, everything, become scholar, and then come to conclusion Krishna is God and the aim of life is to serve him. Another option is simply read this book, 1 book, 18 chapters, 700 verses, and you've got the conclusion, Krishna is God, and you have to serve him, you have to devote your life to him, try to understand him. Which option is better? What do you want to do? Of course, no. You have to read this book. Because if you want to read Vedas, first you have to learn Sanskrit. Because Vedic Sanskrit is different. So I learned Sanskrit. It took me around 13 years. To learn Sanskrit, you need 12 years, minimum 12 years. If you want to read Vedas, normal Sanskrit you can learn. School Sanskrit. That's easy. But Vedic Sanskrit is different. 12 years Sanskrit. Who has got the time? In modern life, nobody has time. You don't have even time to read 1 verse of Bhagavad Gita daily. No? So Krishna knew that this is going to happen. People have less time, less intelligence. Vedas are very complex. And then so many problems, first of all, in life. So Krishna summarized everything into 18 chapters, 700 verses. Now what is there in this book? Let's see. First chapter name is Observing the Armies. So Krishna is standing on battlefield. Arjuna is there. And Arjuna is asking some questions to Krishna. That's where Bhagavad Gita is spoken. Everybody knows Mahabharata. But in first chapter, there are 3 things happening. Arjuna doesn't want to fight. Krishna wants to fight. And third thing is, Bhagavad Gita starts with what? What is the first verse of Bhagavad Gita? Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre, Samabhete, Utsava. It starts with Dhritarashtra speaking. And not Krishna and not Arjuna. You can imagine, if you imagine Bhagavad Gita as a movie, it starts with Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra is a villain. He's a villain, no? It starts with a villain. So what do you say of a movie which starts with a villain? Dhritarashtra is speaking. What happened to my sons and to sons of Pandus? And he is interested to know whether my sons will be alive or Pandu sons will be alive. Arjuna Dhrishtar. He's blind not only by his eyes, but also blind by his mind and heart. He cannot see, he is attached to Duryodhan, and that's why he can't take proper decisions. So we have 2 questions in front of 3 questions. Why Gita starts with Dhritarashtra? Why not with Arjuna and Krishna speaking? And why Krishna wants to fight? and why Arjuna denies to fight. This is Gita. Gita is answer to these three questions. That's all. Finish. If you have answer to these three questions, you have answer to your life. If you don't have answer to these three questions, you don't have answer to life. So, what do you think? Why Arjuna denies to fight? What's the problem? At least externally it looks like that. Because Arjuna says that they are my family, my brothers, Duryodhan, so many. My guru, Bhishma, he is there. And Dronacharya is there. So Arjuna says, how should I kill them? In history, it never happened that anybody killed his guru. It never happened. Well, Krishna, you're asking me to kill my guru. So he was in a problem, no? It seems as if he's attached to his family and he doesn't want to fight with them. But the point which, if you read Gita properly, Prabhupada brings the point in the purport that actually Arjuna was a pure devotee of Lord. As a pure devotee, he was a gentleman. A devotee of God, a gentleman. No, he doesn't want to harm anybody. So main question was not his relatives. Main question was, he was worried, if these people die on battlefield, what will happen? They will lose the opportunity to serve Krishna. Prabhupada says in his purports, he was having compassion. He was having compassion in his heart. Devotees, when they see other people not understanding God, they know that they're wasting their life. Because if you don't understand God, you'll be born again in this material world. That's a rule. That's what Gita is all about. Jan mrityu jara vyadi dukha doshanu darshanam. Krishna says we are bonded in this cycle of birth and death. So this life you are human. Next life you can become dog. It can happen. America, so many people keep dogs. So why? Because if you keep dogs, if you keep cats, you can. I'm not saying you will, but whatever you think at the end of life, you'll become that. I'll come to this. Krishna says this law. And what you will think at the end of life? Do you know what you'll think?
Things we are attached to.
Yes. Things you are attached to. That you will think. Suppose you sleep at night. And you think, you imagine, okay, today in dreams, I will dream of apple. Will you be able to do that? Do you have control in your sleep? No, as soon as you sleep, your mind starts working independently. And then your mind starts thinking of those things which you attach to. Like in exam days, everybody has dreams, no? I'm writing exam. No? Almost everybody. Most of the time it happens, paper is not finishing and you keep on writing. And ink has finished. So, why? Because entire day you are thinking of exams, 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 exams. You dream of exams. So whatever you think entire day, you dream the night. This is a sample given by Krishna to you to make you realize whatever you think entire life, you will think at the time of death. So Krishna is giving you hints. See, this is going to happen. So Arjuna is thinking, these people, Duryodhan and so many people, they never thought about Krishna. They were fighting with Krishna, all of them, no? They even tried to kill Bhima, Duryodhan and Pati. So, and they never served Krishna. So if they're going to die now, what will happen to them? They're going to hell. How to save them? He was worried because of that. And Prabhupada writes in the purport all these things. Externally, he was, by seeing his brothers, he was little attached also. Little attached. How should I kill other people? But internally, he didn't want to kill them. Because he was thinking they'll lose the opportunity. Okay, this is the first question. And the next question is, that's where Arjuna is denying to fight. Everybody understood? Why? He's not in our position. If suppose you were in position of Arjuna, and your brothers, your father, and everybody whom you like, and Krishna says, shoot, what do you do? Do you shoot? Anybody? Yes or no? No. But Krishna wants Arjuna to shoot. It's a dangerous position, no? It's a very difficult decision for Arjuna. At the end of first chapter, Arjuna says, Krishna, I don't want to fight. First of all, they are my relatives, I am attached. But more important is, I don't want to kill them because they never served you. I am also attached to you. And they are not attached to you. They are spoiling their life. They will go to hell. What to do? Arjuna is in a dilemma. But Krishna wants this fight to happen. Why? He wants to torture Arjuna? No, Arjuna, you have to shoot your parents. Well, come on. Arjuna would have argued with Krishna. Prabhupada writes here in the purport. Arjuna argued with Krishna. Krishna, you are telling me to shoot arrows on Bhishma, who is my guru, who is like my parent. But have you shot arrows on your own guru? Who is Krishna's guru? Sandipini Muni. That's his guru. Krishna gave all respect to him, no? So Arjuna argued with Krishna. Krishna, you are telling me those things which nobody is, no human can do. Why you are after me? You can choose somebody else, no? There's so many people. I'm going to forest. I can't fight this fight. But Krishna was adamant to fight this war. Why? Any ideas? Why? Why Krishna wants to fight? Why he wants this fight to happen? Simple.
Restore balance.
Huh?
Restore
balance.
Restore?
Balance.
What
balance?
Good and evil.
Maybe okay. Yeah. You have to refine your answer. You have heard that verse, everybody. Dharma sansthapana yarthaya. Sambhavami yoge yoge paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam. Dharma sansthapana yarthaya sambhavami yoge yoge. To establish religious principles and to destroy irreligion. He wants this war to happen. But this is external reason. Main reason is, in first chapter, in the purport Prabhupada mentions, I'll read for you what's the main reason. Main reason is, you see here, for Arjuna, Prabhupada is mentioning, as a natural devotee of Krishna, Arjuna did not like to retaliate. I explain, he's a devotee. Against the miscreant cousin and brothers. But it was Lord's plan that they should all be killed. Why? The devotee of Lord does not retaliate against wrongdoers, but Lord does not tolerate any mischief done to devotees by miscreants. The Lord can excuse a person on his own account, but he excuses no one who has done harm to his devotees. That is why Lord was determined to kill these miscreants, although Arjuna wanted to excuse him. Krishna wants to take revenge. That's God. So God takes revenge? Have you heard about that? No, no. There's a new concept, no? we have seen God like this. All blessings, all merciful. He also takes revenge. You know why he takes revenge? Because he loves his devotees. Anybody who harms his devotees, he will punish them. Because that is love, no?
But he created everything, right?
That's okay. That's okay. If your child does some mischief, you will punish them, no? So similarly, if there's a criminal, what do you do? All are subjects of king. Criminal is also subject. But the same king will say, hang this man. And that man will say, I'm your subject. You're maintaining me. No, you did wrong. You must be hanged, no? So king is like father to all the subjects, but still he'll kill. Because that is for his benefit and benefit of others. So Krishna saw Duryodhan and all these people, they were always trying to harm Pandavas, no? You see, Duryodhan wanted to poison. He poisoned Bhima. And he made that Lakshagrah, you know that? Try to burn them. And Draupadi, Krishna never forgot Draupadi. All those things Krishna thought, fine, you know, fine, okay. But they tried to disrobe Draupadi. And that moment, Krishna decided, I'll kill them. Even if Arjuna, you don't fight, this fight is going to happen, I'll kill them. Because devotees love Krishna and Krishna loves his devotees. And love means, you have heard that? Everything is fair in love and war. Love means fight also, no? Without fight, what is love? Suppose I come and I abuse your relatives. You will fight with me, no? Why are you doing like that? And if I come and abuse your relatives and you say, no problem, abuse more. I am very peaceful. Then that's not love. No, you can be peaceful, but that's not love. So this is Gita all about. Gita is trying to help us understand what is love. How much he loves his devotees, Krishna. And how much his devotees love him. And that's why this war is going to happen. That's the main reason. Krishna cannot tolerate any offense against his devotees. He protects his devotees. He always protects his devotees. Why he protects his devotees? Why is thinking of devotees? Because devotees are thinking of Krishna. Tit for tat. If you think of Krishna 1 second, he'll think of you 1 second. 2 seconds? 2 seconds. Same. That's a law. 24 hours, he'll think about you. 24 hours. That's Pandavas. And then he can't tolerate. So he can take revenge. Krishna is most merciful and most cruel also. Prabhupada says, there's in Bhagavad Gita, it is said like that. He's most merciful. He helps people. He gives sunlight, air, water, everything. But in form of death, he'll snatch away everything. That is also God. Now, well, you may say, I don't want to die. But it's not in your control. You have to die. Whatever you are attached to, he will snatch everything. If we don't serve him. Okay, so that's first chapter. And the chapter's name is Observing the Armies. I will ask you the question afterwards. Why the chapter's name is Observing the Armies? Just keep in mind. This is a question for you, some puzzle. Observing the armies. Both armies, we are observing them. Okay, now the point is, Arjuna denied. Krishna, I don't want to fight. Finish. So, second chapter begins. Contents of Gita summarized. Now, you know what? If anybody is in sorrow, and if you want to instruct them, they will not hear. You should not advise four people. Never advise. It is said in Dharma Shastras. Don't advise people who are lamenting. They will not be able to hear your advice. They are weeping, no? Don't advise husband and wife. You land into problem. It's their personal life. You can't advise them. Don't advise a brahmana, a sannyasi. You are not supposed to advise them, no? You have to listen to them, no? An audio teacher. And don't advise until you are asked. Until you are asked. Don't advise until you're hired. That's the saying. So in four conditions you should never advise. So the first plan of Krishna to make Arjuna fight, to convince that you should fight, first he has to give him some instructions, but before giving him instructions, he has to get rid of him of his lamentation, no? He has to pacify him first of all. That's the first task. So, that is why second chapter is contents of Gita summarized. Krishna gives Arjuna knowledge of soul. Krishna says, Arjuna, don't lament. Nobody is going to die here. No. It happens like that, no? If somebody dies in a family, relatives come, don't worry, everybody's soul. People say like that, no? Same thing Krishna is saying. That don't worry, everybody's soul. Nobody dies. Everybody lives eternally. This body gets finished. And people take another birth. So don't lament. He gives many reasons for not lamenting. And second chapter, Arjuna's lamentation is over. He settled to hear Krishna's instructions. Why he should fight. That is second chapter. Knowledge of soul. So if you get knowledge of soul, 50% anxieties are gone. Because you understand I am not this body. That's all, finished. Suppose for example, some cut in your finger. No, somebody cuts in your finger. You will feel sad, no? You can weep, no? There's a lot of pain. Now, if somebody tells you that a phone call comes, and the phone call comes, and the phone call comes that your house is on fire, and your family members are burned, will you think about this finger? You'll forget everything about this finger. And just 1 minute back, you were crying for this, no? So what happened? Why did you forget? Because big problems are there, no? So that's the trick. If you have big problems, you forget about small problem. And that's what Krishna is telling. Krishna is telling Arjun, your problems at bodily level, they are small problems. Small problem. Hunger, thirst, small, my bank account, my money, my this, he spoke to me something, they are acting like this, small petty things. It's like cutting the finger. But they are big problems. Big problem is your soul, and you're in this body, and you're trapped in this body. This is a big problem. But we don't realize that. We don't realize it, no? We are trapped. We don't feel we are trapped, no? But this is a machine. We are... If I kidnap you, and if I put in your bag, no? People kidnap like that, no? They'll put in your bag, and tie that bag. So what do? Your first task is to get out of that bag, no? If you're in a prison, in chains, and if I give you all, everything possible, TV, laptop, Mac computer, Apple i6, everything, will you be happy? Anybody? No. You are in chains. He will say, come on, you know, don't give me anything but free me. That is called liberation. We have heard about that term liberation, mukti. People think that it's a big term. It's not big term, it's simple. We were, just like people are chained in prison, we are chained in this body. This body is prison and we are chained. You know how we are chained? Where are the locks? Is there any lock? No lock. But there is lock. You know what is the lock?
Karma.
Okay, karma. Anything else? Attachments. We are attached to this body. And that is why we cannot understand we are not this body. But people who do devotion, people who chant, we were chanting Hare Krishna mantra, no? So in morning we get up and we meditate. This we were singing now, but we chant on these beats. So saints used to chant, no, on beats. What they were doing? When you chant God's name, then slowly you realize that you are trapped in this prison house. And then the desire to get release comes. So you want to get out of this prison house. And small, small problems become small. Big problems become small. First, they become like just like cutting the finger. So you see, if a saint, he has cancer, no problem. But if a non-devotee has cancer, he's gone, he'll go mad. He'll go mad, practically he'll go mad. My God, what happened to me? But for saint, no problem, because he understands this is body. Okay, anyway, this will finish. My aim is to get liberated from this body. That's the aim of life. So Krishna gives his knowledge of soul. Arjuna immediately understands his half of anxieties are over. Now Krishna wants to give him instructions. Why you should fight Arjuna. Now third chapter is, anybody knows third chapter? What's the name of third chapter? Devotees? Yeah, Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga. Third, you know what is Karma Yoga? Karma Yoga is not doing your job. First of all. You have to get out of this conception. Indians think, no? You are Bhakti Yogi, I am Karma Yogi. Many people say, I am doing my job nicely, not hurting anyone, not speaking lies. So I am a good man. So I am following Gita. No. Yoga means linking with God. You can answer me, no? I mean to say, I'll get bored if you don't answer me. It's not a monologue. It has to be a dialogue.
Karma Yoga, I think it is...
No, what is the meaning of yoga?
Yoga means connection.
Yeah, see? Connection with what? With girlfriend? Girlfriend, boyfriends? America is like
God.
That, no?
God, Krishna.
Yeah, God. Linking with God. And karma means action. So karma yoga means using actions to link with God. Simple. If your actions are not helping you to link with God, that is not karma yoga. That is simple karma. That is karma. That is not karma yoga. You are doing karma. And if you are doing karma, then you are subjected to laws of karma. If you are doing karma, you are subjected to laws of karma. If you go on road, if you drive a car, you are subjected to laws of the traffic. If you are in home, and if you are driving your dummy car, you can do anything. toy car. But there, you are subjected to law. So if you are doing karma, you are subjected to laws of karma. If you are doing karma yoga, then you are not subjected to laws of karma, because that's different. That is actions for God. So Krishna says, Arjuna, you fight. You know why? Because fighting is action for whom? What happened to you? Answer me. Arjuna is fighting for whom? Arjuna, for personally, he doesn't want to fight. But Krishna says this fight should happen. So Krishna says, Arjuna, fight on my order. You don't want to fight, no problems. But the problem is, your plans are not perfect. That's the problem. The world doesn't revolve according to your plans. They revolve according to my plans. So you don't want to fight? Okay, no problem. But if you don't want to fight, you will be doing karma. Karma means your own actions, by your own plans, no? And karma yoga means actions for Krishna, actions according to plans of Krishna. This is difference between karma and karma yoga. Most of the people, 99.9% people, are doing what? Karma. They are doing actions by their own understanding, by their own plan. And that is why they are subjected to laws of karma. And if you are subjected to laws of karma, you are going to come back again in this material world, going to take another body. Whatever you are attached, you will become that.
How do you know what to do in karma yoga?
Yeah, that's a good question. It will come. Good question. All these things are... See, question is coming now, no? It's good. If you read Gita, inquiries will come. If you don't have any knowledge, no knowledge, no inquiries. No questions. See? So it's a good thing you're understanding my lecture. Good sign. So yeah. So karma is actions according to your own plans. Karma yoga is actions according to plans of God. And God's plan is fight. So Krishna told, do karma yoga. No karma. If you do karma yoga, no laws of karma, you're not going to come back in this material world. Because if you fulfill plans of Krishna, you will become attached to him. No. It is normal. Whosoever plans you fulfill, to that person you'll become attached. No. Just like for our children, we spend our entire life, we plan for them, no? They'll become doctor, engineer, so we become attached to them. So, but if we follow plans of Krishna, then we become attached to that. Simple. Simple. So, karma yoga is the third chapter. Krishna says, yes, actions for me. Okay. So, now Arjuna gets one point, no? Some understanding. Some understanding is coming. Why should he fight? Now he understands, yes, my plans are not that important. Krishna's plans are important. Even though I don't understand the logic behind Krishna's plan, that he's God, he has got to have some logic. So, let me fight, leaving all my attachment, sadness, limitation, forget all that. Things should happen. That is karma yoga. Now, the fourth chapter is jnana yoga. Without knowledge, actions are useless, no? Is it? Without understanding what you are doing, what's the point of doing? That is superstition. So that is why most of the religious institutions have, people say, no, they are superstitious, mythology. Some people become fanatics. They don't know what they are doing. All the terrorists, ISIS and all those. I mean, Quran is a good book. If anybody has read Quran, I have read Quran. It's talking about peace, surrender. Islam means surrender. You know, this is what Islam word means, surrender. Gita's whole topic is surrender. Same Gita, exactly same. But people who are ISIS, these people, they don't understand what they are doing, why they are reading Quran. So they are now become terrorists, no? So that's why Krishna says, fourth chapter is jnana yoga, take knowledge. If you don't take knowledge, you will become mechanical, fanatic, and you will keep on doing something without any understanding. Just like in India it happens, no? People keep on going to temple, samarti, om jai jagadish hare, jo paave fal, you sing that? What was that song? Jo paave fal paave, jo dhyave fal paave. Dukh bin ko har ka, what's that? My mother used to sing. So that's all ritual. We have to understand what we are doing. No, it's not, we finish something, okay, over, my puja is over. Diwali is going to come, no?
Yes.
Early many people worship Ganesh Lakshmi. So my parents were asking me, okay, Devi, I brought Ganesh Lakshmi. I told them, that's good. You have to do worship, but you know what you are doing, why you are doing. So they told, oh no, you have to do, everybody is doing. And that's blind faith. Why do you want to follow blind faith? So I asked them one question. You know what's the relationship between Ganesh and Lakshmi? What's the relationship? No relationship. Ganesha is son of Shiva. Lakshmi is wife of Narayan. What they are doing together? Why they are together? And so this worship was started 300 years ago. And it's a speculation. That's all. You know why people started? These pandits, no? Pandit? They started this worship. Because people used to come to them. So we want money. Okay, so for money you worship Lakshmi. But if there are obstacles, then you keep with him, with her Ganesh. So Ganesh will get rid of all obstacles. And then you worship Lakshmi and you get all money. That's what the speculation was. But it's not right. You don't know why you're doing. If you have to worship, you worship Lakshmi Narayan. If you want to worship, then you worship Ganesh, Parvati and Shiva. That makes sense. There is no procedure in entire scriptures where you worship Ganesh, Lakshmi. It's just like America, Halloween. Who knows? God knows why. Nobody knows why they are doing Halloween. They have just made a party like that. It was started back Christianity and there was a purpose behind that. On that day, all evils, you know, evil spirits come. So on that day, according to Orthodox Christians, you have to fast and you don't eat meat on that day. You worship Christ like that. But I don't think so. These Americans, they will know why they are celebrating Halloween. Nobody knows. So then it doesn't make sense, no? You're wasting time. So that's why fourth chapter is Jnana Yoga. So Jnana Yoga means Gyan Yoga. Gyan Yoga means what? Now you understand Gyan Yoga. Connect. Yoga means link. Jnana means knowledge. So just like Karma Yoga means linking actions with God, doing actions for God. Jnana Yoga means knowledge, taking knowledge to understand God. Linking knowledge with God. That's Jnana Yoga. Simple. So you are doing actions for God. Now you are trying to understand why you are doing. Karma Yoga will tell you how to do, what to do. Jnana Yoga will tell you why to do. Complete. So Krishna says, fight. That's my plan. Okay, Karma Yoga. Arjuna says, I'm going to fight. Why should I fight? Jnana Yoga. Simple. So Jnana Yoga is not something different. Karma Yoga is different. Bhakti Yoga. People say, you know, choose one. Either Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga. One saint I met in Rishikesh, I asked him, okay, have you read Gita? Yeah, I've read. So he says, in morning I do Jnana Yoga, in afternoon I do Karma Yoga, in evening I do Bhakti Yoga. There's no link, no. There's no link. This is a link. So the fourth is Jnana Yoga, okay. Now Arjuna understood, why should I fight? Why should I fulfill plans of God? That's the question. Why, Krishna, you're asking me to fulfill your plans, your desire to fight? Okay, I'm ready. But why? Fourth chapter is answering this question. Why should we fulfill plans of God? Why shouldn't we fulfill our own plans? Why? And fourth chapter, Krishna says, if you try to fulfill your own desires, entire life, own plans, you will end up in miseries. Because your plans are definitely will be defective, no? We are defective, no? We don't know our future. Just like child, he will ask his mother, give me toffee. So parents will say, no, we'll not give you chocolate, you'll get worms. According to his planning, eating chocolate is good. But parents know, you know, what's the point? Child will say, I want video game. Parents will say, no, study. They know it's good for him, no? So we are like child, no? We plan our life according to our own plans. Krishna says, don't do that. I am your father. I know what is good for you. If you do that, you will mess up your life. And then, once time is gone, it's gone. You can rewind video, but you can't rewind the tape of your life. That you can't do. It's gone. So Krishna says, Jnana Yoga. Okay, why should we fulfill plans of Krishna? Krishna says, if you fulfill my plans, you'll be happy. I know your future. So what I'll tell you, that will be the perfect, but you don't know yourself. And then fifth chapter Krishna tells to Arjuna. Fifth chapter is action in Krishna consciousness. Krishna says, Arjun, fuse both karma yoga and jnana yoga. Fuse them. Do actions with knowledge. Some people will try to understand God. Other people will try to serve Him. Those who serve Him don't try to understand what He wants. Why to serve? Those who try to understand Him do not serve Him. They keep on reading whole day. So Krishna says, no. Understand why, what to do, how to do, why to, and do it. Execute. So I am saying, fight, do that, understand, and that finish. That makes sense, no? Makes sense. So Krishna's plan for Arjuna is to fight. What is his plan for us? For us, it is fighting? No, we are not in that situation. So that is why Krishna begins sixth chapter. Seventh chapter. Sixth chapter is, anyway, before that sixth chapter, what's the name of sixth chapter? Dhyana Yoga. Krishna says, whatever you do with attention. If you want to serve me, if you want to understand what I am, you have to be attentive. You can't be careless. So some kind of focus is required. So that is why we do devotion. We get up in morning, we chant our rounds, spend a morning time for God, no? So that increases our focus and attention. And then that is good. Okay, one hour, you spend entire day, 1 hour in the morning when you are fresh for God. That is Dhyana Yoga. Simple. Yoga means linking. Dhyana means? Meditation, concentration. So you are linking your meditation with God. So morning you are getting up, you are meditating. Chanting His holy names, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Meditating on His names. Meditating on His purpose. Meditating what He wants to tell us. All those things we meditate and then we advance. That is Dhyana Yoga.
Why does everyone say to pray in the morning?
Because morning time concentration is good. See, by afternoon, you know. By afternoon, your mind is full of food, children, husband, phones, Facebook, WhatsApp, so many things. So by morning, it's good, no? Entire sleep will delete your... Sleep is a deleting system, no? It'll reboot your system. So before you put all that, whatever you want to put in your mind, first thing is God. It's clean, no? So it'll sink. It'll sink in your mind. Then and whole day you will be happy. Whole day you will keep on thinking of God. Because first you have thought about God. So that's very scientific. It's nothing to do with something religious things. That is Jnana Yoga, no? Why? Now you understand why. Otherwise people say, get up in the morning, go to temple, come back. I don't want to do in the morning. It's like nowadays, you know, people jog in the evening. You have seen? They do jogging in America also, in India also. They come in evening, 6, 7 o'clock, PT shoes and jogging. So, is there any good for jogging in the evening? It's more harmful. But they don't have time. Why it's harmful? You know why? Because if you jog in the evening, then what happens? You take in air, and by the evening all air is?
Polluted
carbon dioxide. Your breathing has increased and you are taking more carbon dioxide. Your lungs are becoming more polluted. Your muscles might become active, but your lungs are becoming polluted. You're more prone to cancer. So morning you have to jog, because morning air is fresh. The idea is fresh air. The idea is not muscle is becoming active. That's not the idea. That you can always come in your machine, and that machine is a treadmill. For making muscles active, that is okay. But jogging has no scientific reason in the evening. You understand? So that's the idea in the morning. Mind is fresh. Okay, let's engage that in service of God. An entire day, that God devotion, that will shield you. You'll remember God. In back of mind, God will be there. But if you do in afternoon, then back of mind, all other things are there. And then God will come and slip from your mind. So it's not a good thing. Everybody used to get up in the morning and do in the morning. That's a system. Okay, that's Dhyana Yoga. And then comes seventh chapter. Now, what is plan of Krishna for us? For Arjuna, it's fighting. But for us, it is? Krishna says, Arjuna, for you, it is fighting. But for ordinary people, after you, plan is not to fight. I'm not going to make you terrorists. Kill everybody. That's not the idea. Idea, my plan for everybody is to surrender to me, is to chant my holy names. That's what Krishna says. Tesham satyuktanam bhajatam pritipurvakam. Anybody who is always chanting my holy names. We chant holy names, Hare Krishna. And try to read Gita, try to understand me. That is my plan for other people. That's all. Spend your time to understand me and to serve me. That's plan for all of us. That's 7th chapter, knowledge of absolute truth. When you serve Krishna, what is recommended by scriptures? How do you serve God? For Arjuna it is fight, for us it is? For us it is chanting of holy names. Yeah, that's how you serve him. Arjuna is engaging his hands in service of Krishna, shooting arrows. We are engaging our tongue. We can't engage our hands, no. We can't keep on beating, no. People. So we chant, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. We engage our tongue and ears in service of God. That's how you begin service. That is 7th chapter all about. So when you serve Krishna and when you try to understand what he wants, then you come to 7th chapter, knowledge of absolute truth. Then we will want to know who is God. No. The person who I am serving, who is he? How he talks? How he walks? You want to know him, no? You want to know your friend? You want to know everything about your friend, no? So we want to know, then that desire to know God will come. Now we have desire to know this material world. We want to know so many things in material world, no? How this thing is there, how this thing, how you can know, no problem. But there's no desire to know God. So whenever we come to temple, some puja, okay, good. Worship and desire is different, no? There's difference, no? Desire. So 7th chapter is all about knowing God. As you chant his holy name, as you associate with his devotees, as you read Bhagavad Gita, one day will come, you will have a desire. Who is Krishna? Let me know something more about him. Where he lives, how he talks, why he comes here, why so many people cannot understand him, what's so special about him. That's 7th chapter, knowledge of absolute truth. And when that desire comes to know him, then automatically you will try to know him. You will go to devotees, you will ask them, no? Then we don't have to call you in this program, you'll yourself come. We want to. So when is the next program? Otherwise we have to call, please come, please come, please come. Why you want to call? Because you have lack of desire to know God, no? I mean to say, there are so many malls. Malls call you? No mall, Best Buy, Target. They don't call you, no? They don't have a mailing list. Please come. Everybody goes. Because we have desire to buy things, no? So wherever you have desire, there you will go. So we have desire to understand God, you will go to his devotees. Because these devotees can explain you, no? Just like I'm explaining you, no? So if you would have bought this Gita, no, before, you would not have understood any damn thing. I'm 100% sure. You will say, what is happening? No, it's so complex. That's why many people do not read Bhagavad Gita. No, it's so complex. But after I'll explain you, it will become like no problems. Then now you read no problems. So once desire to understand God arises, you go to devotees. Then you search. Okay, where is a program I want to attend? And then 8th chapter is, anybody knows name of 8th chapter? Attaining the Supreme. When the desire to know God comes and the desire becomes very intense, then another desire will come. I want to attain God. I want to meet him. Is it? You want to meet him. How many people want to meet God? Tell me, how many of you? Okay, some people. Yeah, you want to meet God, no? But sometimes you want to meet, sometimes you don't want, no? Hai na? Sometimes we forget entire thing. While sleep, we will forget not only God but ourselves. We are like fully dead. 8 hours, it's finished. So it happens. No, sometimes you want to meet somebody else, sometimes somebody else, somebody else, somebody else. But 8th chapter is 24 hours. A devotee will have just one desire. When will I meet Krishna? When that day will come? He will be doing all his things, no problem. Just like in India, whenever there is cricket match, so people are doing everything, but there is just one desire. When we will open television and see what's the score. That's there in their mind, you know. And they find out time and open, in office they open television, come on television, score. Just one desire, no? They are doing everything, nothing stops. But the desire is there. Or boyfriend, girlfriend, you know. The boyfriend will be working in company, everything, but he has just one desire. When will I meet my girlfriend? The back of mind. So that is what is 8th chapter. When we will know God with devotees, we will have a desire to meet Him. 24 hours your heart will have a desire. When will I meet God? You'll be doing your job, no problem. But as soon as you come from a job, you'll open Gita and read, okay, yes. Who is Krishna? You want to meet Him, no? You want to know more about Him? So that's 8th chapter. And then 9th chapter is, what's the 9th chapter? Most confidential knowledge. So if you have desire to attain Him, you have to follow a process. To meet somebody, there's a process, no? If you want to meet you might have desire to meet Prime Minister. But there's a process. You can't just walk in his home. So that's 9th chapter. Most confidential knowledge. That's most confidential. You develop a desire to attain him. But how to meet him? Krishna defines, gives a process. And the best process is, if you want to fulfill your desire to meet him, what's the process? 9th chapter. Devotion. Here comes devotion. Karma yoga, Jnana Yoga, Dhyana Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. So Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, we started with Karma Yoga, went to Jnana Yoga, what to do, how to do, why to do, Dhyana Yoga, focus, and when you do it properly, then you come to platform of Bhakti Yoga. Now there's a process when you can fulfill your desires, and that process is simple. 3 things you have to do, that's all. Just 3 things. You have to chant his holy names. Chanting, according to how scriptures says. Read his Gita, knowledge. And 3rd is associate with his devotees. Simple. It's not a big thing, no? Is Krishna asking you to go to mountains? Leave everything, go to mountains. Previously it was like that, no? If you want to understand God, leave your house. You've seen pictures, no? Come with me and come to mountains and meditate. No eating, no sleeping, meditate. But Krishna gives a very practical process for this age. No problem, wherever you are, don't worry about that. Anyway, you can't leave. First of all, even if I ask you to leave, you will not leave. Krishna knows. So, he says, oh, no problem, sit. Do just these 3 things. Associate with devotees. Wherever there's program, go to devotees. Make them friends. Anyway, you will have friends, no? Either you make devotees your friends or you make non-devotees your friends. Or in Hindi mein saying hai, jaisa sang vaisa, suna hai, vaisa rang. Man is known by his company. You will become with whatever surroundings you have, you will become that. So if you have company of people who are always thinking nonsense, talking nonsense, you will become nonsense. No? People have nothing worthwhile to talk. They are wasting their time, no? We were talking sports, serials, and then fault finding, no? Usne aisa kiya, usne aisa kiya, usne aisa kiya, usne. What the hell, you know? This is all superficial things. What? Then you'll become nonsense. So you have to be with devotees who have knowledge of God. Knowledge of God will make your consciousness deep. Will give you thoughts to think. Something worthwhile in life, no? So if you have nonsense in your mind, you will produce nonsense, no? That's it. Garbage in ourselves will produce garbage, and then we'll fight. And that's why so many divorces, there are divorces, no? Rates of divorce are increasing like anything. In India, in America, anyway, nobody marries, first of all. There's no concept of divorce. So, but because people cannot live together, that's the biggest problem of this age. Relationship problems, no? AIDS have become very small problem. Hepatitis B, small. Cancer, small. Biggest problem is relationship problems. People cannot keep their relationships because they fight. Why fight? Because in the center of their lives is not God. It's all garbage. So, three things. Simple. It's very simple. And it's nice, no? Is it boring? Do you understand all this? Not at all, no? It's nice. And then you will have nice prasad also. Food. And then kirtans we have. We would have got... Kirtans, if we would have got more musicians, it would have been more nice. So it's a very happy process. You're happy, and in this life you're happy, and then the next life you're happy. It's good business, no? But if you don't understand God, if you don't follow Him, in this life you are frustrated. In the next life, who knows what is going to happen? Risky business. So that is why Krishna names this chapter as most confidential knowledge. It is most confidential. People cannot understand this. There's nobody to tell them. Is it? If suppose people who have come for first time here, if you would not have come here, suppose today, due to some reason, you would have lost the opportunity to understand all these things, no? Is it? So everybody doesn't have the fortune to hear Bhagavad Gita. People can buy Gita, but to hear this from a saint, it's not easy. After many, 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 many lives, you get an opportunity to hear. But if you... But sometimes it happens, we hear, we don't give so much attention, then we go back, we don't make future action plans, how to proceed, now what to do, I've heard this, now how to apply this in my life, then we lose opportunity, and the next life again, maybe next life again you're born as humans, maybe again you come to America, and there's some small program like this, you can attend this program, and again you forget. And the next life, this happens. Why you are in this program today? Why many people are not there? You might have invited other people also, no?
Right.
You know? But many didn't come, some came. Why? Why? Last life you might have done something. Last life probably you might have attended one program like that. But you didn't pursue. You didn't pursue then. It's nice, okay, but then you forgot. You got entangled in your own stuff, whatever you were doing. So Krishna gave you another chance. He's giving you another chance. Okay, take one more chance. Here, if you understand, good. If you don't understand, I can't do anything. Next life. So many people who didn't come, they might not have done anything in their previous lives. So you have done something consciously or unconsciously. You came in association with some devotee, some kirtan, or something you came in association. And that's how this opportunity is given. Everybody is not given opportunity. Everybody is not fortunate to hear knowledge of God. Everybody is not fortunate to be killed by God. For that also you need fortune. That is why in Mahabharata, Arjuna's main point of worry was that these people will die and they will not attain God. That's what he was tensed. So after hearing Gita, Arjuna knew anybody who is killed by God in front of God, he will get liberation. Because presence of God is auspicious. So he told, okay Krishna, I'll fight. I'll kill them. Because he knows after they are dead, they are getting liberated. Krishna is there. So his problem is solved. That's how. This is most confidential knowledge. And then almost it's finished. 10 chapter is, what is 10 chapter? When you do devotion to Him, when you chant His names, read His Gita, associate with devotees, you know what happens? Then you want to know about Him more. You develop love for Him. Then 10 chapter is opulence of the Absolute. You want to know His power. How powerful He is. And 11 chapter is Krishna shows His power. Universal form. You have seen? Virat Roop. So Arjuna says, Krishna, you are powerful, but can you show me? Are you just speaking? Krishna told, okay, I can show you. So he shows his universal form. He shows that Shiva, There's so many Shiva, so many Brahma, so many Durga, but Krishna is one. Krishna is God. Other are demigods. That is Bhagavad Gita. So there are many Shivas. You know, once it is said in scriptures, when Dwarka Krishna was there, and Shiva and Brahma and Indra, they came to meet Krishna. Dwarka? So then the watchman, he told, Brahma has come. Krishna told, okay, put a bench there, ask him to sit. So they put a bench. Brahma was thinking, my God, I am Brahma. And I am sitting on a bench. Then he was thinking, this watchman has gone mad, you know. This Prabhupada explains in Nectar of Devotion, by the way. It's all there in Prabhupada books. So, from one of the scriptures he quotes. So then Indra comes, and then news went, Indra came. So Krishna told, put another bench. Then Shiva comes, and Krishna says, okay, put another bench, let them sit. I'm busy. So then they were going mad. They were thinking, I'm Brahma, I'm Shiva, I'm Indra, what's happening? You know, I'm just sitting outside like a watchman. It's crazy. So then Brahma calls that watchman. He says, you go and tell Krishna, I'm Brahma. So then watchman, he can't do anything, no? So he went and he told Krishna, Krishna, Brahma has come. So Krishna told him, okay, go and ask him, which Brahma? And then watchman goes and asks, which Brahma you are? Brahma was shocked. What is this question? I'm Brahma. Brahma, I can't understand anything. Which Brahma? What is this? And then the same question was Shiva. Which Shiva? All of them were confused. Then Krishna came. And the first question they wanted to ask is, what was the question? The question was not that why they came to meet him. The question was, why did you tell which Brahma, which Shiva, which Indra, what's happening? You know, we are the only people. Krishna said, okay, no problem. Then Krishna meditated and he called all Brahmas. There are so many universes, so many Brahmas. We have universe, one Brahma. So many Brahmas, so many Shivas. In every universe, you have Brahma, Shiva and Indra. But Krishna is one. He called all of them and then they came to know we are nothing. We are nothing. So that is universal form. Krishna showed, I am God. There is nothing superior to me, nothing equal to me. If you read Bhagavad Gita, again this theme is coming. Matta parataram nanyat kinchid asti dhananjaya. Krishna speaks in the last verse of this chapter. Arjuna, matta parataram nanyat, there is nothing superior to me. Nothing even equal to me. Everybody is inferior to me. Shiva, Brahma, Durga, that is why we worship Krishna. You see, people do not know even who is God. In Hinduism, people think it's polytheism, no? So Christians come, they condescend our religion. You believe in so many gods. No, we don't believe in so many gods. Shiva, Brahma, Durga, they're all devotees of Krishna. Shiva, he chants, no? You have seen, he chants. He has beads, no? Yeah. What he is doing with beads? He is chanting something, no? What is chanting? Any guess?
Lord Vishnu.
Yeah, Rama, Rama, Rameti, Mano, Ramai, Ramo, Rame, Parvati asks Shiva, what are you chanting? Shiva says in Mahabharata, Vishnu Sahasranam, Rama, Rama, Rameti, I chant Ram, 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 Ram. Ram and Krishna are one, no? That we all know. They're just same person, different roles, that's all. Incarnations. Shiva told, I chant Ram. So Brahma is also, if you see photograph, he's chanting. So they are not God. They are all devotees, great devotees of God. They are not small people. Extremely great devotees. So when we go to Shiva, we ask him blessing so that we can understand Krishna. When we go to Brahma, Durga Devi, we ask their blessings. Please help us to become devotees of Krishna. That is perfect system. Because they are also devotees. They are big devotees. So that is 11th chapter, universal form. And then 12th chapter comes. 12th chapter is devotional service. In 10th chapter, Krishna told his power. In 12th chapter, Krishna told his sweetness. A person has both, no? Power and sweetness. A person is prime minister. Okay, he's very powerful. In home, he's a sweet person. No, he's not prime minister. So every person has two lives. One is life of power, life of sweetness. So Krishna tells about him both, everything about him, his sweetness, his personal life. And then Gita is finished. It's finished. finish. We know everything about God. His sweetness, His power, how to serve Him, what to do, what is His desire. Finished?
No?
Then what is there in other chapters? 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. It seems it is finished, no?
He tells about universe, different qualities.
No. 13 chapter is nature, enjoyer and consciousness. The problem is, even after hearing all the things, when you will chant, your mind will go here and there. You can't fix. There are obstacles on the path of devotion. It's not always easy, no? You want to do, but you'll not be able to do it. So there are two obstacles. One is internal, one is external. When you try to understand God, approach God, there will be two obstacles. And the two hindrances, and you have to overcome them. So that is 13 chapter and 14 chapter. Two chapters, two obstacles. The name of 13 chapter is Nature, Enjoyer and Consciousness. The first obstacle is within you. Your own mind. You are yourself a big enemy for yourself. This is secret. We think he's enemy. No, the greatest harm if anybody can do to you is you yourself. The secret? No. If you tell to your neighbor, he'll say, what the hell you are talking? You've gone mad? I'll do harm to myself? No, that's a problem. That is 13th chapter. The most confidential, more confidential knowledge. Krishna says, we want to enjoy this world. A mind wants to enjoy. That's an obstacle. Don't try to enjoy this world. If you want to be happy with me. Don't try to be happy without me. Is it? You know, it happens, in this material world. Suppose if you have one girlfriend, boyfriend, and they love each other. If that boyfriend makes some other girlfriend, and if she loves him very much, you know what she will do? What she will do? You don't see movies? No, if she's very attached to him, she'll kill him. She'll first kill him and shoot herself. Because she'll not be able to tolerate, that he's with some other person. So that is the same problem the same problem with the mind. We want to enjoy without Krishna. We want to enjoy without Krishna. So you know what happens? Krishna is one energy, Maya, illusory energy. Krishna loves us so much. He loves us so much. He cannot tolerate that you love somebody else. So what he does? He'll kill you. Death. That's why we die. Yeah, he can't tolerate. Why should you love him? I love you so much. Krishna loves us so much. And you're loving somebody else. He can't tolerate that. So he says, okay, if you don't love me, die. Until unless you don't love me, you'll not be happy. That is 13th chapter. Problem with the mind is, we want to be, Krishna is not saying don't be happy. Be happy with me. You'll experience more happiness. There is no happiness there. There is disturbance. So if you go to a party, DJ, DJ? I don't know, America, you have DJ. DJ, your dance party. It's enjoyable, but the next day is hangover. No, it's headache, so much problem. So that is what, that enjoyment will lead to headache. But enjoyment with Krishna will lead to peace and satisfaction. In that enjoyment, there is no peace and satisfaction, there is disturbance. But in this enjoyment, there is peace and satisfaction. Do you agree? Krishna says in Gita, kutah shanti kutah sukham. So that is 13th chapter. There is peace and satisfaction. Peace. If you ask anybody on this planet, are you happy? They'll say, I'm happy. Going to Disney World, this. Are you satisfied? No. Nobody is going to answer, I'm satisfied. I'm not satisfied. Are you peaceful? No. So there's a difference. In that happiness, there's no peace, satisfaction. In this happiness, there's peace and satisfaction. So that is 13th chapter. Internal obstacle. We don't want to be with Krishna. And 14th chapter is external obstacle. External obstacle is our own friends, our relatives. They will say, oh yeah, you went to that program, we would have gone to movie. You messed up our program, why did you do that? Happens, no society. They'll say, what you are doing, what you are chanting, you know, devotion, this is for old people. It's time to enjoy. Let's enjoy. So that's external obstacle. There are two obstacles, internal, external. So 14th chapter, the name of 14th chapter is three modes of material nature. Material nature will try to stop you. Mode of ignorance. You have heard this tamogun, rajogun, satogun. Have you heard all this? Mode of ignorance, mode of passion, mode of goodness. These things will try to stop you. People, objects, television will call you, come to me. Is it? And Krishna is calling you, come to me. But that power of television is so great, you'll go to television. Okay. They attract, no? Things will attract you. Then if you start devotion, things will attract you more.
Temptation.
That's the idea. So that's external obstacle. There are so many temptations all around us. So they'll call you, come, let's enjoy. So that's external. So these two obstacles you have to overcome. How to overcome these two obstacles? Do we have power to do that? Yes, that is 15th chapter. What is 15th chapter's name? The Yoga of the Supreme. So Krishna tells in 15th chapter, always pray to me. More than that, remain with my devotees. You need protection, no? We need devotees to protect us. Is it? We are like child, no? On this path, we are beginning. So we have to be with devotees. That's 15th chapter, Yoga of the Supreme. Be with my devotees. Pray to me. And follow what I am saying as it is. Then you will be happy. 15th. And then, when you are doing devotion nicely, you should also know you are advancing. The signs, no? You should have symptoms. We are doing something and God knows what's happening. I'm advancing or not advancing. What is happening? It's 20 years in devotion and I'm chanting and nothing is happening. Then it's frustrating, no? You should know. So 16, 17 chapters, two chapters, two signs of advancement. How do you know you're advancing? So many people in India, they are doing puja, ting, 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 and same. Same, no? That is why at one point of time I became atheist, you know. My grandmother, she is doing some puja and then shouting and then doing all kind of, all same person, you know. I thought this is nonsense. The definition of religion according to Gita is Swabhav Adhyatma Uchyate. Religion should help you to change your nature. That is very nice definition of Bhagavad Gita. Is it sectarian? Krishna doesn't say, this is Hindu Muslim. Krishna says, any religious practice will help you to change your nature. If it doesn't help you change your nature, bogus. It's just following process. That's all. So two chapters, two symptoms. Now what is 16th chapter? What's the name? Divine and demoniac. So when you do devotion to Krishna, all good qualities will come, bad qualities will. Your nature changes. That should happen. If you are doing devotion, same angry person. Same thing. Why are you going to temple? You know, what's the point? You know. So all good qualities will come in you. Ahimsa, Satyam, Saucham, Tapa, Arjavam. This list in 16th chapter, starting. What are good, what is bad? So you can checklist, okay, these good qualities are coming in me. So all good qualities will automatically come to you. Because Krishna is all good, you connect to all good, you get all good qualities. This 16th chapter. And the 17th chapter is divisions of faith. Shraddha Traya Vibhag, that's Sanskrit. Your faith will increase in God. Naturally, no? That's another sign. Your faith will increase. Your faith will increase means... We were reading in morning. When faith increases, your knowledge about God increases. Is it? My faith in God is increasing, but I don't know anything about Him. That makes no sense. Your faith increases, your knowledge about God increases. When your faith increases, your service increases to God. So that your faith increases. These two things should happen. You get good qualities, and your faith will increase. And mature, become strong. then anybody will tell you, this is all nonsense. Then you can prove to him this is not nonsense. Your life is nonsense. So if anybody will tell you that I am happy in my life, you are happy in life, okay, good. We don't say that. We didn't say we are happy, you are not happy. Our proposal is that. Because we know that your happiness doesn't have peace and satisfaction. And you also know this. Is it? They'll admit. So that is 17th chapter. Your faith now is based on knowledge. Nobody can confuse you. That is 17th chapter. And then 18th chapter, last chapter. Last chapter is final words. Sarva Dharman Parityajye Maam Ekam Sharanam Vraja. Krishna says, don't worry, Arjun. Whatever I've explained you, just follow this. There might be many people saying many things. You might have some fear. If I do all these things, I'll become sannyasi. People have this fear, no? Everything will... I'll leave everything. What will happen? No, nothing is going to happen. Is it? Does my face look something special? No, nothing. I'm same person, no. All devotees, it's all same. It's all just have tilak different. But tilak is nice, no? Tilak is so nice. If you have this tilak in on your forehead, it is said in scriptures. Even demigods come to worship you. They see, you look beautiful with tilak. Without tilak, scripture says, any person who doesn't have tilak on his forehead, his body is a crematorium. You understand crematorium? Shamshan Ghat. It's dead. There's no life. This means lotus feet of God. This feet of God, this tulsi. So it signifies that our life is surrendered to God. That's where we put. So when we do chanting and all, we put this. There's a significance to this. So Krishna says, don't fear. Ma socha, don't fear. You come to me, I'll protect you. I will help you to overcome all obstacles. Mind obstacles by mind, obstacles by people. I'll give you faith, I'll give you strength. I'll give you all knowledge. You will be able to argue with anybody. And that's all, finish. That's Bhagavad Gita all about, 18 chapters. Yeah, it was a crash course. 1 hour, 12 minutes. 1 hour, 12 minutes. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. We discussed Gita now. It's over. Any questions now? Yeah, you want to ask? You're asking something? Okay.
Can you speak something about Om?
Om? Yeah. This is a nice question. Krishna says, all your answers are in this book. 100%. So Krishna says in 10th chapter, Om iti ek aksharam brahma. Krishna says, Om is my official name. Aksharam Brahma. Whenever, if you go to office of Krishna, Krishna's name is Parbrahma. You have heard in scriptures? Brahman, Parbrahman. Okay, no problem. So that is official name, Om. Krishna is his personal name. So now, if you want to worship him officially, you can chant Om. But if you want to worship him with love, then what do you say? Krishna. You don't say official name. That is love, no? So that is why we chant Hare Krishna, because it is path of love. You want to develop love for him. We don't want to have official relationship with God. No satisfaction, no? So, there's no difference. Om and Krishna are both names of God. No difference at all. But the results are different. If you chant Om, you develop an official relationship with God. Krishna is God, you're down, he's up. But there's a problem with official relationship. You know what's the problem? Problem with official relationship is, if you do some mistake, then you get, reprimand. You get fine, punishment. Official, it goes like that, no? Some mistake, punishment. So that's a tough path. That is 12th chapter. Same your question Arjuna asks. Krishna, what is the difference between Om and Krishna? So Krishna says, that is a path. It is recommended by scriptures. People chant Om, but difficult, because even smallest mistake will be accounted. This is office. But when there is love, you can do 1,000 mistakes. No account. No problem, no love, no problem. So that's easy. Path of devotion is easy. That is why we chant Hare Krishna. We don't chant Om. Om is, it needs a lot of rules and regulations. lot of practice, it's not easy to do. It's clear. But it is mentioned in scriptures. It is not unscriptural thing, but probably not practical for all of us.
I have a question actually. In Gita somewhere, I don't know the exact sloka, but Sri Krishna tells that all other people who are praying to God, praying to me in different form or formless, or different,
they're
offering to me, but it comes in a different way to me only.
Yeah, Krishna says, that in 6th and 7th chapter, he says, however a person surrenders to me, and ultimately he comes to me. Manush, Vartaman Varteshu, that's a verse, I forgot that verse full. The point is, Krishna is saying in that verse, that if you worship me according to scriptures, any path according to scriptures, that will lead to me. But any path leaving scriptures, mental speculation, then that will not lead to him.
Mental?
Speculation. By our own, we make path by our own mind, no? All these pandits and anything you do. This is Ganesh, Ganesh, Lakshmi. No result. You can do. But if you worship according to scripture, Lakshmi Narayan, then there is a result. So scriptural path will help you to understand Krishna. But then among scriptures, there are different paths. I told you Om and Krishna. But what is happening today is people are making their own ideas and then saying you follow any path and you will attain God. That is bad. That is wrong. That is wrong. Concoction?
Concocted, yeah.
That's wrong. So we need scriptural knowledge. Then that's okay.
One more question is, it's not related to Gita directly. Once you told that there are many Brahmas.
Yeah, many Brahmas.
Sivas.
Yeah, yeah.
How many Vishnus are there?
Vishnu is... Vishnu are also many. But Krishna is one.
Krishna is one.
Then, yeah, but there's a difference between many Vishnus and many Shiva and many Brahma. Vishnu, generally people think Krishna is avatar of Vishnu, but it's not like that. Vishnu is coming from Krishna. That's Gita. But in television you might have seen serials, it's not like that. It's wrong understanding. From Krishna, many Vishnus are coming. Many Brahmas, many Shivas. Krishna is one. So, but there's a difference. When you have many Brahmas, those Brahmas are different. Different living entities. Just like suppose, in this universe we have a Brahma, Mr. X. Example I'm giving. In another universe we have Mr. Brahma, Mr. Y. Understanding? Some other universe, Mr. Z. Like Shiva also, in this universe you have Shiva, Mr. X, another Mr. Y. So they are different persons. But so many Vishnus, they are not different persons. Vishnus are all reflection of Krishna. You understand? Just like you have, suppose there was sun. And sun is reflected into, sun is reflected into ocean, into lake, into a bucket of water. All are reflection of sun. So Vishnus are reflection of Krishna. But Brahma and Shiva, they're all different living entities, different people.
Then,
different people.
In Krishna, again, while worshipping Krishna, some people, some places, there is only Lord Krishna.
Yeah.
And somewhere, there is a Krishna and Radha. So
why
Radha part is coming?
Anybody knows why Radha?
The necessity of that.
Yeah, good question.
But how many Radhas are there?
Radha is one. Krishna is one, Radha is one. So why Radha is there? Anybody knows why Radha?
Why Radha?
She is a topmost devotee of God. So we don't worship God alone. Because if we try to approach Krishna alone, without help of his devotee, we cannot do anything. That's the idea. So Krishna mercifully keeps Radha with him. So that people, Radha is embodiment of mercy of Krishna. She is not female. She is not female like us, like all of us. She is Krishna's mercy. If you take all mercy from Krishna, make a form, that is Radha. So that is why we worship Radha Krishna. Because whenever we go to Krishna, you know what? Krishna is God. So Krishna will say, okay, what sins you have done? I'm God, no? I'm judge. And if he counts your sins, go back. So Radha is standing. So Radha says, no, forgive him. No problem. You forgive him. Radha is mercy, no? Forgive him. Please accept him. So by the petition or what? By the petition of Radha, Krishna will accept. Otherwise, there is no chance. That is why Sita Ram, always female counterpart is there. So that is energy of God, mercy of God. So it helps us to approach Krishna easily. That is why we chant Hare Krishna. Hare means Radha.
You told the greatest devotee is Radha. Who is Narada?
Who is Narada?
Narada
also devotee of Krishna, but he is not greatest devotee. Shiva is also devotee, but they are not greatest. Greatest is Radha. Nobody can compare to Radha. Because Radha is Krishna himself. Krishna expanded himself into Radha. No, phone or call. Okay, any other question? Otherwise, we are done with this. So, no confusions, huh? No confusions, really? Mostly TV, yeah.
That God will, rebirth of Krishna. Krishna will come. Krishna was born in the real world. That is why.
No, Krishna is not born because it is said in scriptures, Krishna appeared. If you read Krishna Leela, he appeared.
Okay,
in
appeared, but
jail.
His presence was there in the real world.
Yeah, yeah.
So, does it say anywhere that
yes, he will appear as Kalki Avatar. It is said in scriptures, after 4,032,000 years, he'll come again.
From now,
4,032,000 minus 5,000. 5,000 years are gone of this age. So it is how many years? 2 and 3. 4,027,000 years from now, Krishna will come again. 4 million. That's a big thing, no? But it's said, plan is already made. We have to understand that plan. That's all. It's already chalked out. He's going to come again. But why to wait of his coming again? Finish your business, go back to him. Just finish your business. Prabhupada said, finish your business, go back to him. We don't want to come back again in material world, no? It's a problem, no? Struggle, this, that. In Krishna's planet, when you go back to him, every day is a festival. Every word is a song. Every step is a dance. That's, you'll enjoy with God. You'll enjoy beyond your dreams. That is spiritual world. But
since we do not have any form.
We do not have any form by?
The spirit does not have any form.
No, who said spirit has form?
Yeah,
but that is, soul cannot be cut and burned. But that doesn't mean it has any form. It's in, Gita says soul cannot be cut, it cannot be burned, it cannot be made wet. Nanam chindanti shastrani nayanam dhati pavaka nayanam shoshati maruta. So, but it is having form. Spiritual form. They have spiritual form. The two hands, two legs, same, but spiritual form. That is 9th chapter Krishna is explaining. 9th and 15th chapter. They have form. Is it form? What is formless? Formless has no meaning, no? There can be nothing formless. What do you mean by formless? So, if you get liberated from this body, you become formless. This statement has no meaning. Formless means you destroy your existence, no? Where you are, like, what is? It is illogical. Everybody has a form. God has a form. We go back to him. We enjoy with him. We serve him. Simple. Otherwise, it's illogical. Is it clear? There's no logic to formless. Okay, so thank you very much for giving your time.